Hello everybody, my name is Michael Wagner. I am professor of digital media at the Westphal College of Media Arts and Design at Drexel University in Philadelphia. And this is a tutorial on how to use Ambisonics in Ableton Live 10. Now, the tutorial itself is going to take about an hour, so I've decided to split it into four different parts. Now, in the first part, which is this part, we are going to talk about what Ambisonics actually is and why we would like to use it. We're not going to go into too much detail, so don't expect a very technical tutorial. It's really, really the idea to be hands-on and to be practical and to actually utilize our information in Ableton Live. Now, in the second part, we're going to talk about how to produce audio in Ableton Live that is in Ambisonics format or that follows the Ambisonics format. And in the third part, we are going to talk about how we are going to monitor that, because we not only want to produce audio, we actually want to listen to it. So how are we going to do that? How are we going to listen to something that is a completely immersive audio format? In the fourth and final part, we are going to talk about how to record Ambisonics. Because we do have that problem that Ableton natively is not capable of bouncing tracks in Ambisonic format, so we need to find another way to get that information out of Ableton and to record it onto our hard drive. And that's something that's easy to do, and we're going to talk about in the fourth and final part of this tutorial. But let's first look into what is Ambisonics and why do we actually want to use it. Now, in its simplest way, we can think of Ambisonics as an extension of the mid-side stereo processing paradigm. So if you're familiar with audio production, you are most likely familiar with the idea of mid-side processing. Now, what that is you're taking a stereo signal, which has left and right information, and you're converting that into a signal that contains the ambient information, the so-called mid-channel, and the side information, which is sort of the information on the sides of the stereo spectrum. And the reason you want to do that sometimes is because that allows you to optimize the stereo impression, which is something that is particularly important in modern music. So modern producers use that quite often. Now, if we extend that idea and not only have one side channel, but actually use multiple side channels, so for example, three side channels for the three principal directions, we can move sound sources not only left and right, we can actually move them in three-dimensional space, and we're getting a fully immersive sound experience. And that is at the center of the idea of the Ambisonics format. So it allows us to position sound sources in three-dimensional space. That is the main advantage. It is sort of one format that allows us to create fully immersive audio experiences. Now, where are the applications? Now, obviously, one application is in virtual and augmented reality, and that is actually one of the reasons why that got me interested in that field. My own background is not in music. My background is in game design, actually educational game design. And we've recently started the virtual and augmented reality efforts. We are also starting a virtual and augmented reality program, an undergraduate program. So it became sort of natural to look into what is required to produce audio or to produce sound for virtual and augmented reality applications. And in doing so, I noticed that there's not a whole lot of information out there, even though in theory, most of the stuff we're going to talk about, it has been around for a long, long time. But there's not a lot of practical information out there, simply because it has not yet been something that people have been particularly interested in actually using in a real world application. But with virtual and augmented reality, this is changing drastically and rapidly. So more and more people are really interested in that. So I found it necessary to kind of look into that. The second application, obviously, is game design. You know, if you are creating games, most game engines, actually all game engines, can actually handle Ambisonics audio. And the final and also the obvious application is anything that has to do with immersive audio. So any immersive audio installations, art installations that kind of play with the idea of positioning sound in a three-dimensional space require some format that allows them to do that, and that format is Ambisonics. So when we talk about ambisonics, we are actually talking about a whole series of formats. So there's not one ambisonics format, there are different ambisonics formats, and these ambisonics formats come in what's called orders. So there's a zeros order ambisonics format, which is not particularly interesting, it's just the ambient channel. A first order ambisonics, which contains what I've just talked about, the ambient channel and then three side channels. And then there are higher order ambisonics, second order, third order, and it actually can go up indefinitely. The most we are going to use in this tutorial is third order ambisonics. But Reaper, for example, is capable of handling up to seventh order ambisonics. So there are systems out there that allow you actually to do better than that. Now, the reason we want to go in higher orders is essentially that the higher the order is, the greater the resolution is. So the experience that you get is more accurate the higher the order of the ambisonics audio is. But for most of the things that we are going to work with, the first order ambisonics, as crude as it is actually perfectly fine. Now, one thing to think about ambisonics is also in terms of what's called virtual microphones. So when you come across an ambisonics diagram, you usually see these weird blobs like here on this sheet. And what these blobs represent are microphone characteristics. So the first three channels in the first order ambisonics information, so the three side channels, can also be thought of as the information that you're getting if you have bidirectional microphones that have figure eight characteristics, the characteristics that I'm showing here on the slide, that have these characteristics and the audio that they capture essentially represents the corresponding components on the first order ambisonics information. As we go higher up in order, these characteristics become more and more complicated. So in second order, for example, the virtual microphone characteristics look something like this. Now we call them virtual microphone characteristics because there aren't really any real microphones that have these characteristics. So if you go out and want to actually capture ambisonics in a real world environment, you cannot really do that with actual microphones that look like that. You have to reconstruct the virtual microphones through the information that you're capturing with your particular ambisonics microphone setup. Now, the reason they are looking so complex is essentially mathematical. So it is sort of the way spherical functions are deconstructed. There's not much we need to know about that. The only thing to know about it is that there is actually a reason why we are doing it like that. And that sort of has a mathematical background. And if you go into third order ambisonics, the virtual microphones look even more complex like that. Now, once again, what we are going to do most of the time is we're going to be working in third order ambisonics. So we're going to produce third order ambisonics. Now, we're going to only monitor first order ambisonics. So, and that essentially means we need to convert the third order ambisonics into first order ambisonics. And fortunately, that it's very, very easy to do. It's actually trivial. If you want to kind of, if you have a file of a higher order ambisonics in a higher order ambisonics and you want to converted into lower order ambisonics, all you really need to do is you need to drop the corresponding channels. So if you have a third order ambisonics file and we want to convert that into second order, all we really need to do is drop the last seven channels and that's it. The first nine channels are going to be representative of the second order ambisonics and by the very same logic, if you drop the next channel, the first four are going to be the first order ambisonics. So when we produce third order ambisonics, 16 channel third order ambisonics, and we just take the first four channels and channel them through a first order ambisonics decoder, the result will be perfectly fine. And that's actually what we're going to do. And we can actually take that one step further. If you remember the second channel, so the first channel in the first order ambisonics components is the left-right side channel, or is equivalent to the left-right side channel. And the first component, which is the zeroth order ambisonics component, is sort of the mid-channel. So the first two channels in the first order or in any ambisonics format really are sort of representing mid and side channel. And we can actually use that by piping these two channels through a mid-side decoder. And by doing that, we will get a reasonably good representation of the ambisonics file in a stereo format. And we're actually going to do that at some point. So it's actually very easy to kind of work with that file once we have it encoded in a certain way. Now, the one thing I need to point out at that point is that when we look at the virtual microphones, one thing that we notice is that all these virtual microphones are centered at 0, 0, 0, so the center of the coordinate systems. And that means that even though we are constantly talking about positioning a sound source in three-dimensional space, once we have encoded that sound in an ambisonics format, the actual distance to the listener is somewhat lost, right? So the mathematically, it is not really possible to reconstruct the distance information out of the ambisonics channels. That is not really a big problem for us. A sound that is very quiet but close might be completely identical to a sound that is very loud but far away. So for most of the applications, it's not going to be a big deal for us. For very immersive applications in virtual reality, for example, we could recreate an impression of distance by constantly recoding the ambisonics format so that essentially the ambisonics changes or the ambisonics file changes in real time depending on the listener position. That would give us some distance information or an impression of distance. And most of the decoders, in addition, also try to recreate some of the distance information from cleverly interpreting the reverb information that is in the file. So by kind of analyzing the reverb, you can actually kind of try to identify the distance of a sound source. And we will actually see that the decoder that we are going to use is doing that to some extent. So it's recreating some of the distance information, but nonetheless, most of the distance information is lost once it is encoded. And that's really all I needed to say in terms of the theory and the background. So it's now time to get our hands dirty, to start up Ableton, to get started and to produce something. And that's what we're going to do in the second part of this tutorial. And for those of you that are familiar with Ableton, which I'm assuming many of you are, you will probably already notice we have one big problem, and that is that Ableton can only handle stereo tracks. And we are talking about a 16-channel format. Now, fortunately, there's a very easy workaround in Ableton Live 10, and that's actually why this tutorial is specifically for Live 10. So what we're doing is not going to work in the very same way in Live 9. And that's something we're going to discuss in the second part of this tutorial. So see you at the second part of this tutorial, and thank you for watching.